California is experiencing the worst whooping cough outbreak in more than 60 years. KPBS and the Watchdog Institute at SDSU spent 4 months investigating why a disease that was nearly extinct 30 years ago has infected thousands and killed 10 babies. The investigation took the team across California and overseas to Amsterdam, but began in a San Diego hospital delivery room.
Matthew Jacob Bryce was born October 11, 2010, a healthy baby, the third boy for Cindy and Marlon Bryce. Matthew started showing signs of a cold when he was just 2 weeks old. The Bryce family knew something was wrong.
It just seems like this cold was just like, it was just affecting his breathing.
The family was aware of the whooping cough epidemic in California from news reports.
State health officials say more than 6,400 cases of whooping cough have been reported this year.
Matthew's doctor suspected it could be whooping cough, also known as pertussis. She took a nasal swab and sent it to the lab. She also started Matthew on antibiotics. 6 days later, with Matthew just 23 days old, Cindy Bryce got a phone call from the California Department of Health. The diagnosis was whooping cough. From January to October this year, 10 newborns in California died from whooping cough, two in San Diego County. More than 7,000 children and adults got sick from the disease, the highest number in the state in more than 60 years. Pertussis is a respiratory illness caused by the bacterium Bordetella pertussis. At first, it can mimic a cold, but later produces a violent and persistent cough, a cough that leaves children gasping for air, creating that distinct whooping sound. For adults, whooping cough may only be a nuisance, but to infants, whooping cough can be deadly, especially if not diagnosed early. Young babies aren't able to cough up secretions that collect in their lungs, leading to pneumonia and making it difficult to breathe. Early antibiotic treatment is most critical in this age group. Whooping cough was nearly wiped out by the late 1970s because of mass immunization, but it somehow found its way back to California and other highly vaccinated communities around the world. Just why it's made such a vengeful comeback has two of the world's leading whooping cough experts in disagreement. Dr. James Cherry of UCLA.
The main reason is increased awareness.
And Dr. Fritz Moy of the Netherlands Center for Infectious Diseases Control.
We found a kind of new mutation in the bug.
Dr. Moy and Dr. Cherry both began their research into whooping cough about 30 years ago. Cherry in the U.S. and Moy in the Netherlands. The two scientists know each other's work.
I mean, first of all, his molecular microbiologic science is, he's, you know, right at the top of scholars. So there's no question about that. I think where some of the things as he's published is the clinical data are not very good.
I don't communicate too much with him, but what he wrote in the press is that I screw up epidemiology. That doesn't help me too much.
To understand why these two experts disagree, you need to know a little about the history of the pertussis vaccine. The bacterium that causes whooping cough was first isolated in Belgium in 1906. At the time, the illness was one of the leading causes of infant death. The discovery led to the first attempts at a vaccine. But it wasn't until the late 1940s scientists developed a vaccine effective enough to prevent whooping cough.
Unlike the disease, however, a vaccine does not endanger life.
By 1946, mass immunization programs began in the U.S. and the number of cases dropped dramatically. Prior to the vaccine, the rate of disease was 157 cases per 100,000. By the 1970s, with large-scale immunizations, fewer than one in 100,000 people got whooping cough. But the vaccine was not without controversy. The early versions were associated with side effects such as prolonged crying spells and seizures in babies. By 1996, the FDA approved a new whooping cough vaccine. It was called an acellular version. That means the vaccine uses only purified components of the disease-causing organism. That vaccine was considered to be safer and associated with few mild side effects. Today, the U.S. uses only the acellular pertussis vaccine.
And then you're getting the Tdap shot, which includes the whooping cough.
But as the United States was changing vaccines, something else was happening. Health officials across the country were reporting increasing numbers of positive whooping cough cases. And in a government lab about 30 minutes outside of Amsterdam, a group of scientists had discovered something else. The bacterium that causes whooping cough started to look a little different.
And so this new mutation had the effect that the bacteria started to produce more pertussis toxin.
Just whether that mutation is to blame, at least in part, for the California epidemic and outbreaks elsewhere in the world is at the heart of the whooping cough debate. Dr. Moy believes this to be the case, but not Dr. Cherry.
Even though these changes have occurred, there's no evidence that that's led to increased vaccine failure.
Just how effective is the vaccine? That all depends on who you talk to. Drug information included with the two most commonly used whooping cough vaccines in the U.S. say the vaccine is 85% effective. Dr. Moy believes there's no way to determine how effective the vaccines are because they have not been tested against the new strain of whooping cough.
We call it the P3 strain.
A strain he believes is more virulent and can make people sicker. The strain emerged while the new acellular vaccines were being developed.
Well, I can tell you one of the reasons why the vaccine companies are not too happy with me is that if what I say is true, they selected the wrong strains in the 1980s.
There's absolutely no evidence that either of the two vaccines that are most common today used in the U.S., that there's increased vaccine failure with either of those vaccines.
Cherry says the increase is also due in part because of something called waning immunity. Immunity to whooping cough does not last a lifetime, whether you're vaccinated or develop natural immunity from getting the disease. Almost all experts agree waning immunity is contributing to whooping cough outbreaks worldwide. Where they disagree, when does immunity fail? Dr. Moy says public health officials should be encouraging cocooning, immunizing all those around newborn babies. But in the long run, he says, we need better vaccines.
Matthew?
Baby Matthew spent 4 days in the hospital and was eventually discharged. Today, he's getting his 2-month routine checkup. Despite a stuffy nose, Matthew is doing well.
As you might know, the vaccine is not as effective as we want it to be. And that's one reason why there have been a lot of cases going around. But with Matthew in particular, his own immunity has kicked in, you know, from having the illness that is in effect a sort of a booster, if you will, that'll protect him going forward. And how long that immunity lasts is still a question mark.
Since KPBS and the Watchdog Institute began this investigation, state health officials, the CDC, and scientists from UCLA, including Dr. James Cherry, began a new study to determine whether a more virulent strain of pertussis is contributing to the current whooping cough outbreak. To see the entire documentary, When Immunity Fails, the Whooping Cough Epidemic, go to our website, kpbs.org/envision.